A European parliamentary delegation visited former Philippine Senator Laila de Lima on the eve of her sixth year in detention. The parliamentarians were also well received by the Philippine Justice Secretary, in contrast to the hostile reactions they met Wednesday from some senators.
A day before she marks her sixth year under detention on drug charges, former Senator Laila de Lima received some visitors Thursday. Five parliamentarians from the European Union dropped by her detention facility at the PNP Custodial Center. The Philippine National Police and de Lima's team have yet to release details about the meeting. The EU delegation belongs to the EU Parliament Subcommittee on Human Rights, which had previously expressed concern over the former lawmaker's prolonged detention. But the parliamentarians were mum about the details of their meeting with de Lima, just as they declined to share information about their subsequent meeting with Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla. It was Remulla who told reporters the visiting lawmakers raised the issue of de Lima's detention during his meeting with them. He told the lawmakers his agency will not oppose any move to secure de Lima's freedom.
Yung kagaya na sinabi ko dati, probably habeas corpus might be the remedy. Kasi yung bail nila dati na fail na, na-dismissed na yung dating bail petition. We already offered to back channel before, but there was no response. We just want things to end properly. We will not oppose it.
Also discussed during the meeting, the lawmakers' concern over the spread of fake news in the Philippines. Although Remulla made known his personal position that he does not want the cyber libel law to go after fake news peddlers. Unlike the European parliamentarians' tense meeting with senators on Wednesday, Remulla said his meeting with them was constructive.
Ang karamihan nito about judicial reform, correction reform, sa ating reforms on prosecution, reforms on bail, lahat ng mga ginagawa natin na improvement, parang nagugulat sila. Kaya hindi na pumasok para mag-argue kami. Hindi sila argumentative actually.
Even the contentious issue on the International Criminal Court was discussed only for a few minutes.
Ang sabi ko lang doon, inaayos na rin namin ang sistema. Kung may problema talaga ang ICC na gusto imbestigahan dito, ibigay na lang sa amin, kami na ang gagawa. Kasi yan, these are crimes committed in the Philippines by Filipinos, di ba? Kami na lang ang gagawa, hindi na sila umirit.
On Wednesday night, the EU parliamentarians also met with human rights groups and civil society organizations. Among those present, the Philippine Alliance of Human Rights Watch Advocates, the National Union of People's Lawyers, Karapatan, and Human Rights Watch. Karapatan Secretary General Cristina Palabay said the discussion included the continuing extrajudicial killings in the drug war and counterinsurgency program of the country, the climate of impunity, the International Criminal Court probe, and the alleged harassment of activists, political prisoners, and members of progressive groups. But some of them were disappointed with the government's response, according to Carlos Conde of Human Rights Watch. The Philippine government supposedly just doesn't listen. The EU delegation is set to hold a press conference on Friday before heading home. Remulla, meanwhile, will return to Geneva, Switzerland on Monday to speak to the UN Human Rights Council about prison reforms in the Philippines. Meanwhile, about 6 in 10 Filipinos believe the spirit of the EDSA revolution lives on. That's according to the latest Social Weather Station survey that was released ahead of the 37th anniversary of the peaceful uprising. 62% of poll respondents said the spirit of the revolution is alive, while 37% said otherwise. The 1986 EDSA revolution was a civilian-backed military uprising that ended the 14-year dictatorial rule of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s father. Marcos has declared today, February 24th, a special non-working day in commemoration of the revolution's anniversary. A proclamation issued by the president says this would enable Filipinos to enjoy a longer weekend in line with the principle of so-called holiday economics. The Presidential Communications Office has yet to say what activities the Marcos family will have on the day of the anniversary itself.
Protests are expected to be held to mark the anniversary of the People Power Revolution. Joining us now is Dennis Abariento, spokesperson of the rights group Karapatan in Central Visayas. Good morning, Dennis. Thanks for joining us this morning.
Good morning po, and for everybody.
All right. So I understand your group plans to reenact a protest that happened at the Fuente Osmeña in 1986. Can you tell us more about that? What is the significance of this reenactment now?
Yes, we're going to commemorate the People Power Uprising that happened not just in EDSA actually, but all over the country, in particular here in Cebu, which was known as the bailiwick of the opposition during martial law. There has already been ongoing na mga protest action in Puente Osmeña through jogging and display of different colors, especially after Rudy Romano, Father Rudy Romano was abducted in July 1985, and from then on the protest actions against the Marcos dictatorship has been going on until this erupted in the February People Power Uprising. So today we're going to assemble at the Fuente Osmeña and to have a same program there, and from Fuente Osmeña all the participants, including not just mga activists, but also even those who were participants in 37 years ago are expected to come, and will be moving around the Puente Osmeña circle and then towards Camp Sarili Osmeña, the regional headquarters of the police here in Central Visayas, to reenact the Abbas actions that was always the feature of this dictatorship in the height of martial law. So outside of the camp this morning.
That is such a just the elephant in the room. How do you think the identity of the sitting president would impact how we remember and commemorate the EDSA revolution? Do you think this administration should acknowledge the rights of unionists, human rights advocates to be protected from their illegal arrests due to their activism?
It's a sad thing, no, na until especially karun sa kuan in the reign of President Bongbong, na it's so early in his reign, we have already documented at least 15 cases of political killings and 100 cases of illegal arrest and without warrant. There are additional 30 arrests and detention of activists and other persons due to their political beliefs. Here in Central Visayas, at least 105 political prisoners, and 6 of those are in Cebu and 13 in Bohol. The rest are in Negros Oriental. This is sad because we are supposed to be already in a democracy, and yet our mechanisms, the remedies that are provided by our constitution are conveniently disregarded, dismissed by those in power, including the police enforcers, when they harass and detain. And in the case of Armand Dayoha and Dayan Gumanaw, tortured while in incommunicado detention from January 10 this year until January 16. So in the time of Marcos, that was in the height of its of martial law, the people are fellow Cebuanos and the rest of the Filipinos were not in any way intimidated to go out in the streets and to insist on their rights, so much on now that we are in the foot in the reign of the son of the former dictator. So even
how do you think that fact would impact the way we commemorate the EDSA revolution?
So even though these cases are also ongoing, we are seeing the assertion of our rights by our, not only by the victims but also by others who have voted for him in during the past election, and this will even encourage other people to come renew their commitment to freedom, independence, and solidarity in this today. Kay this has become even more relevant now with all these persecution that is happening, and non-access to local remedies to violations that are being committed against our rights.
Mm-hmm. And we will know, just like in the days of dictatorship, misinformation and human rights have remained an issue haunting the government, even before, during the administration of former President Rodrigo Duterte. Mm-hmm. How can we continue the good fight against this?
It's inspiring to note that the victims of the political killings and even those who are victims of Tukhang have not been cowed by the continuing persecution against them from the time of the Duterte's administration until now. We are continuing to organize them, and in fact we have already gathered some of their testimonies, and these were already submitted to the International Criminal Court. We're happy that these testimonies has already been accepted, and we're looking forward na they will see their time to be presented and to present their cases in the International Court, because we really have no chance at getting justice here in our country with the continuing harassment of the witnesses, of the lawyers, and the human rights defenders. So we're hoping that the international arena, through the United Nations and the International Criminal Court, will provide what the local justice system cannot.
All right. On that note, thanks for speaking to us this morning. Dennis Barrientos of Carapatan. You stay safe.